to the real estate panel. I borrowed some tape from the sound guy in case anybody talks too much. People they accuse me of joking around too much as a moderator, so I wore a pink tie. I'm going to let you go down the line, starting right here with James. Introduce yourselves and tell about what you do.
Jim Jones, IRA Services and the IRA Exchange. We work with opening up retirement accounts to the crowdfunding industry.
Hi, I'm Jillian Sidoti. I'm up here because, as you know, I do Reg A's, but 85% of my clients are real estate related, so.
Hi, Mitch Nydish, president of CrowdFund Builder. We build white-labeled crowdfunding websites for the commercial real estate industry.
I'm Joel Block. I manage the Bullseye Capital Fund. We buy distressed assets, and I've also put together a group of professional fund managers, and we're building on a platform called Investor Valet.
I'm Mark Lancaster. I'm president of Great Lakes Fund Solutions. We're an outsourced back office for those who raise money from retail investors, and we have CrowdKey, which is a white-labeled platform.
Great. I'd like to start with James. James, now, Blaine was talking a few minutes ago about how some of the investments are approved for IRAs, private shares, and some are not. And so could you tell me what would make a private share approved and or one that's not approved?
I think, and if Blaine is here, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I think the approval was from the broker-dealer side. As far as any security being approved for an IRA, there is no formal approval. When you make an investment in a self-directed IRA, the compliance just making sure that there's no prohibited transaction or prohibited people involved in the deal, such as a fiduciary being involved, or if an owner is making an investment in an asset of which he's more than 50% owner and receives direct income, or it might be a direct family member.
Okay, now my girlfriend has been looking at these real estate portals like Patch of Land and Realty Mogul, and she got $10,000 out of her IRA and wanted to put it into one of these portals. How possible is that? How permissible is that? How good an idea is that?
So it's done very simply to move money from what we would call a traditional IRA or a brokerage account IRA, like at an E-Trade, a Schwab, a Merrill Lynch, Morgan Stanley. You can move it one of two ways. You can do it in a rollover, which you have 60 days, where you obtain the money physically, and you have 60 days to deposit it into your new custodial account, or you can do a direct transfer. And it can either be an in-kind direct transfer of all of the assets, or it can be just a simple cash transfer. Uh-huh. And so there's done right and properly, there's absolutely no tax liability.
Uh-huh. Okay, now, Jillian, you're a real expert in this, and you do regularly do Reg A's for real estate. Mm-hmm. What do you think about this Title III? Is that a non-issue, or is it going to be a good idea for little small companies in Ohio that want to buy a few apartment buildings? Is that going to work at all, or is it a complete waste of time?
Well, I don't know if it's a complete waste of time. I think it's a good way to get, you know, started. It's not a growth strategy at all. To me, the idea of taking only $2,000 from a particular investor and that's it is and you can only advertise on the portal that you're on, kind of thing. I just think that's so restrictive that it makes it in a lot of ways not worth it. Are you looking for a long-term growth strategy, or are you looking to just get something up quick and cheap? And you know, at the end of the day, you're going to get what you pay for with Title III.
Yeah, but I got to go through all kinds of trouble to do Reg A, and it seems like that Title III, I can just post on a portal and finance a few of those apartment buildings in my neighborhood.
Well, okay, so I know I mentioned this earlier, but in the book, I wrote this book, the book is called Crowdfunding Myth, and that's one of the myths right there, is that you can just throw something up on a portal and voila, it's going to get funded. That's not how it works. You can't just throw something on a portal and expect magic to happen. portals have to work to get those investors, and not every deal is good to those investors, and not every portal is created equal. Not every portal is right for that type of issuer. So, I mean, I know there's something wrong. I'll give you a perfect example. I know there's something wrong with a deal if I go on Patch of Land and see something that's over 13%. Like, I know Patch of Land is not going to Patch of Land's deals are 10 to 11%. On the other side, if
you
I
mean I can make 10% of my money on one of those things?
You could, but on the other side, on ground floor, you can make 13 to 15%. And I know if I see something on ground floor that's 10%, there's something wrong with that deal. So that's what I'm saying. Not all crowdfunding portals are the right portals for all deals. You got to find the right portal for your deal, and you just got to you have to work to drive people to that portal as much as that portal is going to work to drive people to your deal.
Okay. Now, I know this is a topic that Joel loves. Joel, what about the risk on some of these real estate portals, especially if we have a downturn in the market? What's going to happen to all those investors that have put their $5,000 into Patch of Land or Realty Mogul or any of the other ones? What do you foresee for that?
Well, actually, it'd be interesting for an attorney to weigh in on this because there's some legal structure issues. But I think that more experienced operators are going to be better equipped to deal with the downturn when that happens. They'll be better equipped to negotiate with banks, better equipped to just prepare themselves in advance. People have been doing this for a long time. It seems to me like a lot of the platforms, have deals that are sponsored by part-time amateur mom and pop kind of people. I won't say all of them. There's a handful that are out there being promoted by professional promoters, but by and large, my experience is that professional promoters don't find the deal that many of these platforms put out to be very attractive. They're too fee heavy. They don't want to share the back end and so forth. And the other thing is that professional promoters tend to find deals that need a little bit more elbow grease, and many of the platforms don't want to take these deals that have some value add characteristics. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So my greater concern is that a lot of the platforms seem to have enormous amounts of conflicts of interest. They're getting paid fees back and forth. There's brokerage arrangements, and it's very difficult to tell. They use these SPVs. It's hard to tell who owns and controls the SPV. And Jillian, I'd be interested to hear your opinion if you are familiar with a lot of this stuff. But it just seems to me like if there was any kind of a collapse of the platform,
yikes,
what would happen to these borrower-dependent nodes, mm-hmm, and these other kinds of vehicles that are being used?
Well, I mean, if I just to respond to Joel, if you don't, mm-hmm, mind, sure. I don't mind borrower-dependent notes. I've invested in a couple of them myself on ground floor in particular. Patch of Land has in the past been a client of mine, but it's not my favorite. And for just the same reasons you just talked about, is how is Patch of Land or ground floor totally separating themselves from these situations? So, you know, that is a reason, an argument for Reg CF right there, or the Form C, you know, which Sharif is proposing in CrowdFund Express and some of these other portals I've seen, is that everybody's going to offer their own deals, and I have nothing to do with it. I'm just helping you out by putting it on my portal, and that's it. And maybe you're paying me a fee to be on that portal, which is, in turn, is why I love CrowdStreet in particular, because CrowdStreet is like, look, you pay us $25,000, and we'll list you on our portal. The end. But for all of those reasons, I'm not a huge fan of payer dependent notes, because it's almost like, with some of the bigger companies like Lending Club or Prosper, they have indentured trustees. Wells Fargo is going to come in and take over if something happens to Lending Club or Prosper. But these other smaller operations, that is not the case. There is no indentured trustee. No one's coming in to take over. So they have to be really creative on how they're going to secure those interests for the investors. Sorry, Gene, I'm not trying to take over.
Speaking of portals, hang a second, Joel, because we're going to get to your fund in a minute. have a real estate legend in Los Angeles that's seen all. He's a lot late to the party, and he says, I'm going to make a portal. So I know who can answer that. What should he do, and what would be the procedure if he wants to do a portal?
So we work with a lot of existing.
Pull the mic a little closer to you. There you go.
Sorry. So we work with a lot of existing real estate development firms that have been around, and I think the key question that they come and ask me is, our investors are aging out, what do we do? We're not online, so we help them with a white labeled solution where we can customize the site to fit their specific needs. They don't have to go on to one of the other portals where they don't know the other deals that are on there. They're worried of, what if there's a tarnished deal on there, and what's going to happen to us if something happens on that portal?
Well, this fellow has a long string of good properties, okay? He's adept at finding absolutely terrific properties.
I think I know who you're talking
about. And he goes around and he gets a group of his friends and they buy these little buildings, apartment complexes and things like that, and he thinks that he's going to put those on all of them things on a portal. Is that a good idea, or should he
have good IT and marketing people? Does he want to be in that business of driving people to the site?
That's a good question.
I think that's the key determinant as to whether he should list mm-hmm. on an existing platform or go for his own platform.
Well, Mark, while we got your attention, should he do accredited only, like most of the portals are, or now should he do a REIT where he could get money from non-accredited investors, a whole lot of non-accredited investors on his portal? Would that be some advantage over the other portals that are out there now, only taking money from accredited investors?
He probably already knows the answer to the question.
He doesn't know hardly anything on the type
of investor that he's had in the past.
If it's who I think it is, he should stick with the accredited investors.
I think there's a big problem with the non-accredited investors and educating them, as a lot of them haven't done deals like this before. They need to know what they're getting into. There needs to be proper education on the sites. Also, managing many, many investors for a deal. If you're raising a couple million dollars, you don't want thousands of investors. It's hard to manage. There's a lot of costs there. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of expense.
So what are some of those costs? I mean, if he wants to do a real estate portal from, and he's a very frugal guy, you know, so very, very frugal guy. And he says, oh, my gosh, is that expensive? That's probably why he hasn't done it yet. He's afraid to spend any money. What would a portal, if I wanted just from hello, how are you, to have a working portal taking investments in real estate properties, ballpark, what are we looking at?
You could be in the $25,000 to $50,000 range.
That's what I told him. That's pretty okay.
Right. Who's capturing the money?
Yeah.
Now, Mark, in that environment, here's the big question. You took investments. Let's say you did put up a portal and took a lot of money from non-accredited investors. Don't you think that's going to be a real nightmare, because the people are going to say, well, I didn't know this thing was this, I want my money back. What are you going to do in a situation like that? And do you think that's going to be a problem with real estate portals?
I think it's a definite possibility that the folks that have been raising money in the independent broker-dealer channel for years have live in fear of information on their deal getting out and getting in the hands of a plaintiff's attorney, particularly if
or better yet, an irate redneck coming by your office saying, "I want my money back," right?
Mm-hmm.
Why does it have to be a redneck? Why does it just be an IRA person?
The rednecks are even worse than regular people.
it's a legitimate concern that, you know, there's more operational work, communication, and heartache associated with having a big pool of investors. And I think that frequently kind of gets assumed away in the crowdfunding space.
I haven't seen very many Regulation A REITs, like official, full-blown, publicly traded Regulation A REIT that's listed. Is there a reason for that? Is it because we're still early, or is it because people are afraid of that? Or, I mean, maybe there's some private REITs. Anybody wants to take
well,
this?
First, it's brand new. First and second, what is a Reg A applicant, if you will, or issuer have to do? They have to sell all their stock before they can even get listed. So that's what we were talking about with Sharif earlier. Sharif's not a REIT per se. He's a real estate investment fund that's selling stock. There is no tax. If you're wondering, is there a tax advantage here? Absolutely not. There's none. So that's what a REIT technically is. A REIT is nothing more than a tax advantage that you have to do all jump through all kinds of hoops in order to get to that tax advantage.
Tax pass-through is
exactly.
The advantage, okay.
And so Sharif is a real estate investment fund that is stock. When he sells out of his stock and he says, okay, Jillian, I'm done selling stock, that's when I can go to FINRA and apply for a stock symbol. And then I can go to OTC markets and apply to get listed.
Okay, now that brings to light a question. Mm. Since a Regulation A Plus is an ongoing, can be an ongoing offering raising up to $50
million, right.
Could I do a mini max and list? Let's say I get $20 million of the 50 and go ahead and list and then have an ongoing offering and raise some more? Or does that listing lock me in some way to no further offering?
No, well, you just have to you almost have to re-register the securities. You have to, it's not registering them. You'd have to re-qualify the securities. So in other words, you'd have to file another form, 1A, with the SEC and get that re-qualified for those securities that you elected not to sell when you, I mean, that's a great plan, Gene, actually.
Don't they have to be the same price as the original issue or something? Is there some restriction on the price?
There might be.
Mark,
it depends on the SEC.
Oh?
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I don't mind asking you. If I've got a Reg A and I've gotten my $20 million, I didn't get the whole 50, but I do want to go ahead and give the liquidity or minimal liquidity to my shareholders. And then I say, well, you know what? There's interest in this offering and it's trading and everybody's buying it. Maybe I could sell some more. Is that a possibility?
Sure.
Yeah.
You just don't want to, oh, good Lord, I'm going to say this on camera. You don't want to, because I can't think of it a better word, you don't want to piss off your current investors.
Especially those rednecks.
because you're underpricing the stock. So let's say you sell it at $10 a share. It starts trading at $12. You don't want to come out with another $20 million offering at $10 a share because your current investors are going to say, you blew it. You blew it for me, and now I can go buy it here for $10 a share instead of buying it on selling my stock on the market for $12 a share. So there's that issue.
Okay. Now, Joel, as I understand it, you're only going to have accredited investors in your fund, right? You want to tell me,
our current fund, which was set up before the 506B rules, so it's just under the old 506 rules. We have mostly accrediteds and a handful of non-accrediteds. Through my career, I've dealt with an awful lot of different kinds of investors and raised a lot of money. I personally don't really like working with non-accrediteds. And when I qualify every investor into our transaction because we're going to be with them for a long time. I mean, these are people. I don't even think of them as customers or investors. I think we're going to be on the same team together for a long time. And so I talk to everybody. I spend almost an hour with each person and make sure that they understand what's going on. I try to make sure that they understand, what their own financial circumstances are. And, there's some accredited people that don't have liquidity to be involved in a deal like ours either. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons people wouldn't qualify. But these non-accredited, when somebody says, I got an inheritance, and I want to put it all in here. Well, what other money do you have? Well, that's all the money I have. Well, not a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
My experience is that if somebody puts in $5,000 in a situation, that's maybe all the money they have. A guy that puts in 50 probably has 10 50s spread across many different things.
Mm-hmm.
And,
The SEC feels that way, too. That
well, and listen, I'm not a big fan of the nanny state, but I think that the problem is that people that don't have a lot of financial wherewithal don't have a good understanding, and they don't have access to resources to help them get a good understanding of the complexities that this world brings to the table. And money is about the most complicated thing in our society. It is very complex, and it's people don't understand it. You can tell they don't understand because they have a hard time getting it. People just have a hard time getting money to come to them, and people who have a hard time getting it to come to them don't understand a lot about it. So I'm very leery about the
I like if you got any ideas on how to get it easier, I'd love to know.
Well, that'll cost you. If the money comes to me, then I'll tell you the secret.
Well, now, but what is your fund actually going to do?
Well,
suppose you got millions of accredited investors, yeah, and they're all your buddies. What are you going to do with it?
The next round, you know, we're building a platform. It's going to be a 506c platform where we're going to attract accredited investors. You know, all of our investors. We just this week sent out distribution checks, and I already have investors. You know, a couple of non-accredits calling. Why didn't I get more? You know, don't you owe me? Isn't there a schedule I'm supposed to get paid every certain day of the month? No, you don't. You know, read the operating agreement. You'll understand how it works. And you know, it's you know, it's there's just a lot of misunderstanding, and there's a lot of room for error. And my experience is, you know, listen, in 30 years, I've never been subject to a regulatory complaint or an investor lawsuit, because I try to have good understanding. Things don't always go perfectly, but I try to have a good understanding of the expectations with the people in advance. Mm-hmm. And you know, with these non-accredits, especially when they start coming in randomly. You know, well, you got to
like
understand.
Like on the internet, right?
From the internet, you know. Listen, it's one thing for, all right, you know, Bill introducing his neighbor Bob, and Bob, you know, I look fine, so we know each other, or at least. But when a stranger drops in $5,000, and if I don't want to take too much time away from everyone else, but there's one last thing. I think that has to do with trolling. You know, there are these patent trollers. You know, they look for patents, and they sue them, okay?
Hate them.
And in Los Angeles, and I don't know about other cities, we have these disabled trollers. You know, the guy rolls up in a wheelchair, and he has to go to the bathroom, so he goes in the store and measures the mirror. It's supposed to be 36 inches. It turns out to be 35. Sends you a bill for $5,000. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to change the rules so that, you know, the guy gets a letter to have time to correct it. But there are people that make their living by doing these this kind of little situation. It's really
terrible. I've heard there are some attorneys that do that, too.
Well, there are
there
some.
Was. No, there was two attorneys who got disbarred for serially doing it. And
but let me tell you, here's the application to this. So for $5,000, somebody drops some money in your account. 2 weeks later, they sue you that there's something they're not happy about. And they say, look, give me $30,000, I'll go away. I could just see it happening. Mm-hmm. So what our platform is going to do, and again, we're dealing with accredited only, and you know, it's all of our guys are professional syndicators. The one thing that's going to be different about our platform is that there aren't going to be any outsiders. The only people that can use our platform are partners in the company. Is we're not only going to vet the deal makers and put them through background check, we're going to vet the investors on the way in too, make sure they're not serial plaintiffs. Because I'm telling you, there are problems on the horizon that you guys cannot yet imagine. A lot of you are service providers. Most of you don't manage capital. You don't deal with investors every single day. Dealing with investors is time-consuming, and there's lots of different things that come up. And you know, y'all going to help everybody raise money, and then you leave, and then the guy's stuck with those people for years. And it's a bigger challenge than you think. So I'm not saying that in any kind of a negative way. Y'all do the job you're supposed to do, but then the guy gets the money, and all this crap that he didn't understand was going to happen starts happening.
It's not You've been there, right? It's not the real estate business anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Mark.
Well?
Mark, what do you think? What do you think about all this?
Well, my answer is that you should outsource the
You're not a troll,
services.
Are you?
No. One of the problems I see is that it's not only when the phone rings or when you have sort of disingenuous people investing in your fund, it's that you have 1,000 investors and you work with them over the course of many years, distributing income and return of capital and sending out reports and trying to do this in an Excel spreadsheet is an invitation to get it wrong, especially as you're trying to continue to be in the real estate business. Mm-hmm. And so having a proper database and working with a group of people who and it's not the first time they're managing a back office is a good idea.
Well, that brings up the question of, you know, I know, Joel, I know you're working with Folio, and suppose that I work with a large brokerage like Folio that has all these things in place to vet investors and issuers. Isn't that going to help me an awful lot, rather than just having my own platform and trying to do it all myself?
Well, actually, there's a lot of benefit that comes from working with a broker-dealer. The way we set it up with Folio is going to be the broker-dealer who oversees the investor relationships. We hired another broker-dealer to oversee the issuers that are part of our group. Mm-hmm. So the second one, which is called Monarch Bay, They're in Los Angeles, so yeah, you know, they live to be nearby them. Yeah. They're excellent guys.
Yeah.
And so what they're gonna do all the due diligence. They're gonna set everything up. They pass it to Folio so it can happen faster than it might happen otherwise.
Sure.
So we have a couple different groups that are doing different things. And what I understand from Monarch Bay is that really, you know, the real, if a bullet gets shot, it's probably gonna get shot closer to them than closer to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we've turned all this stuff over. My objective, as somebody who's been in this business for 30 years and really kind of understanding the investor mindset, is really, I think that, you know, right now there's this many people who are investing in crowdfunding deals. And we talked this morning that maybe there's 10 million accredited and way, way more than that, you know, non-accredited. You know, the only way that the professional distribution community, which already exists, I mean, you don't want to displace these people. The people already exist. I mean, we've got a wonderful network out there. You're going to have to pay them some money to play, you know, but they're not going to do crappy deals. They're just not going to do like a rehab of a single family house. They just won't move their clients' money into that.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to want to do hotel deals, and they're going to want to own parts of Puerto Rico, and they're going to want to own this. Bigger, more prestigious properties that professional managers do. So I really believe that
Steve Sadler's company can manage for
them. You know what? And we'll talk about that.
Yeah.
Because that's what they want, is they want professional management, professional reporting, professional, you know, high quality
stuff. I've
heard
Steve can really do a great job.
Yeah. And it sounds like you can too. You know, I mean, so, you know, I mean, listen, I think that this industry is going to coalesce around professional people.
Okay. Now I'm getting the signal that we only got a couple of minutes left, so let's have some questions. Yes, sir.
What percentage of non-accredited investors do you think will see a return in their investments within, say, 5 years in Title III? Who you asking?
Anybody? I guess anybody on the panel. The question is, what percentage of Title III investors would see a return?
I'll tell you what I think. I think that most of the Title III deals are going to probably be venture-driven deals. I think that venture is the seed money before venture.
Can you describe
venture account-
a venture-driven yeah,
so
deal?
Venture is a business, okay? So the entrepreneurial business, it's the creation. Venture capital comes in after the angel capital guys, which comes in after the seed money, the friends and family people. I think that Title III is going to be brilliant for bringing in new people into the seed round of a new idea. I think it's a great place for that to happen. Those businesses typically do not generate returns unless they're sold or unless something very exciting happens to them. So, you know, those are mostly zero or hero kind of deals. The other thing is, if they're set up as equity, there's no way for anybody to get their money back. Equity doesn't have a dividend guaranteed. It doesn't have an interest payment. You know, so for the most part, people put their money in, they're going to be stuck. But they're only putting in a tiny amount of money. And that's the reason the government limited that, so that nobody gets hurt too badly. I mean, and you know, as much as I'm not a fan of the nanny state, I get it, and I agree with that. Put a little money in, and that would probably be a good thing to do. But I think that the number of dollars that come back, most businesses fail. Most venture-funded businesses fail.
Mm-hmm.
Here's another problem that these companies are going to have, is that there's not professional oversight. Kickstarter's had a terrible problem with this. You know, they make a great video. They come up with some idea for this cooler that has a watermelon chopper and a blender and all these different things. You know, and he dreams this thing up, and it's awesome. He makes a video about it, and he sells 65,000 of them or something, and raises $13 million. But then he goes back to build it, and it turns out to be a lot harder than he thought, he didn't know how much it was going to cost. Because marketing something and operating something are not the same. And, you know, so a lot of these younger people are doing a great job of marketing. They're not great at implementation. And at the end of the day, if, you know, they're not big companies that have, they're not 10 or 20 or 50 people companies that have many different people good at different things. They got one guy who's going to come up with an idea. And I think that there is going to be an extra high failure rate because of that reason.
Any more quick questions?
Percentage of those will make in 5 years.
Under five. Five.
Under 5%.
Very low.
Yeah. Private equity firms look at 110 hitting off, and they're professional.
That's venture.
Yeah.
I once had a venture capitalist say, you know, we only hit 1 out of 10 deals. I said, so you really need to admit that you don't know what you're doing. Any other questions? Yes, sir. 97%
of the profits in venture are captured by the top 5 firms in the industry.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The vast majority of the firms are money losing, and they've underperformed the S&P for the last 20 years.
Okay. Anybody else? Huh? Okay. So here's the thing. What's the future going to be? What's the future? We see right now, we see some wonderful things on the horizon. We can get money that we never got before. We can generally solicit like we never could before. There are new models for getting funding. New people are going to be allowed to come in at some point. And over a period of time, things are going to change even for the better. I think, you know, they're talking about Jobs Act 2.0 and stuff like that. So what do you go down the list here? What do you see as the future of investing in real estate through crowdfunding?
I think perhaps a good example of that we saw last week at the ReefaCon event. Jillian was there, and Sharif and Richard, and the REA is the National Real Estate Investment Association. They've got about 40,000 members, a couple hundred chapters across the country, and they basically match up real estate investors with investment sponsors, plus third-party advisors, and they teach people how to invest in the real estate business. And traditionally, this REA association has been a little bit more older school real estate, but what was interesting at the conference, the three-day conference last week, everything was crowdfunding. It was all about crowdfunding. Everybody wanted to get involved in it. They wanted to understand it. There was a lot of great panels and presentations, and the gentleman, Scott Whaley, who runs the association, he's invested $500,000 of his own money trying to, you know, build out a platform and exchange, but what he's trying to do is bring the industry together for the real estate and get involved in crowdfunding. So I think you'll see the masses.
Weren't there rednecks there, were there?
I didn't see any, no.
Okay, Jillian.
God, you and the rednecks. For those of you that have seen me answer this question before, I'm going to say the same answer. You know, I have a 64-year-old aunt who is retiring very soon, and on New Year's Day, we were having a little New Year's Day party, and she said to me, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do if we have another market crash like we did in 2008. If we have another market crash like we did in 2008, half my retirement's going to go away, and I can't have that happen. And I said, and she said, all of my money is wrapped up in a particular stock because that's what her 401k invests in. And I said to her, well, you know, you could invest in some crowdfunding sites and get into some real estate deals if you would like. And I said, you know, you could make about 8% on your money investing in a real estate deal on a crowdfunding site. And she almost fell over. She couldn't believe that there were these sites out there that you could invest in and get 8% return on money. And it was really awesome to her that there was this new opportunity. She started writing down, literally right there, writing down websites. Like, which website? I was like, well, let's start with Fundrise, and we'll go from there. That's the direction we're headed in. We have a bunch of people who are retiring, who are freaking out, can't have another 2008 happen to their retirement account. You know, we have a bunch of young people who don't trust the stock market at all. And then we have, you know, a bunch of people in the middle who are all stock market refugees who have been shell-shocked by losing all kinds of money in the stock market. So I think we're going to see a huge uptick. Now, it's our responsibility as service providers on one level or the other and as issuers to do it right. Let's not create a bunch of crowdfunding refugees.
So we're going to see a platform on every corner?
I sure hope so. I see that in the accredited arena, more and more companies are going to be raising money online, especially as the investors start to age out and don't invest in these deals anymore. They're going to need to start to raise money from someone a little bit younger. These people are online. I know maybe today the millennials don't have all the money, but the day is coming soon when they will be the ones with some money and they'll be investing in the accredited deals. Again, in the unaccredited arena, I think the impetus is on both the platforms and the issuers to educate this audience of what they're getting into, to clearly tell them in a very clear offering memorandum that here's what you're getting into. Now, if you looked at most offering memorandums, these are unaccredited, haven't looked at them. They don't know what they're getting into. They're not real clear. The information, you could jump around and never find what they're looking for. So I think there's a lot that needs to be done so that we educate this audience. And I'm a big proponent that everyone should be background checked as far as if you have a portal out there and there's a tainted deal, it's not going to just pull down that site. It's going to hurt the whole industry. So I think we really need to do a good job when we look at these things moving ahead, that everyone from the issuer side and the investor side, that we're looking at who's putting money into what deals and what deals are going up and what are the track records of the issuers, so that we all know when we go to invest in a deal, I can see the history. Here's what they've done. They've lost money. They've made money. But I know what I'm getting into. And I think that's what's going to really take a lot of hard work to get done. But if all of that's done, I think we'll all be very successful growing the industry.
Right. Joel, what's the future?
You know, there's a trend that I never hear anybody talk about, but I think it's going to be the biggest one going, and that is you have this tremendous convergence of the public equities markets with the private equity markets, which is the area where I operate. I operate in private securities. And so, as a private securities person, I've always wanted to get my stuff into the hands of the public securities guys because that's where all the money is. But there's always been this Chinese wall. We don't have enough diligence. We don't have enough balance sheet. We don't have enough of many different things, and they can't go near us. The public securities guys, on the other hand, these RIAs and these guys, they take 1%, let's say, as a management fee. If they're generating 4% for their clients, they're taking 25% of the guy's money away every single year. So if that person could inch up the yield somehow by adding another asset class, they want exposure to real estate and other things outside of publicly traded REITs, because those are just the same as buying stocks. So they want exposure to us.
Well, not necessarily, because a REIT would have generally some sort of consistent dividend of income from the properties.
That's true.
Plus, it has the underlying properties as a true asset value, whereas some stocks are valued like who knows. The sky's the limit.
No, that's true. But if they're publicly traded, they're going to have market risk. They're going to have the prices are going to fluctuate and so forth. And people get nervous about that. Whereas private securities do not. So and the yield is rather low on most of those things anyway. I mean, they just end up being rather low. So if an RIA can increase the yield on his portfolio, by adding some different asset classes, the kinds that we all talk about, then they might generate 5 or 6% on the average for their client, and then their fee might be, instead of 25%, might be 15 or 20. Mm-hmm. So that's advantageous for them. So for the first time really in history, we're kind of starting to understand them, and they're starting to understand us. We're still far apart. We don't understand a lot of each other. In fact, some of the speakers today were saying there's a lot of jargon that those of us on this side don't understand, and people, and you're talking about issuers that don't understand things. The truth is that we're from different worlds that have never been in contact with one another before, and that's starting to happen now, which is a very cool thing. And that's going to grow the pool from 10 or 20,000 crowdfunding investors to potentially millions.
You know, Mark, everybody's got this look like I'm waiting for cocktails, but what do you think?
We have more time.
More time? Okay.
Mention something, if I may.
Sure.
As a comment, we all have a responsibility as an industry. This new industry is not even, but the fiduciary responsibility, and I go with Mitch, said everybody has to be background check, but as a media, we just don't print anybody, just send us and said, I have, this is new platform we have, and who they are. We have to kind of guard it.
Sydney, that's about the most important thing that anybody has said here, because everything is so new and the press loves controversy. And so when some of these deals go south, they're going to concentrate on that and they're going to say, oh, crowdfunding is not such a great idea after all. So we all have this tremendous responsibility to the future, actually, of financing. And Steve, I'll be there with you one second. Just let Mark finish on his comment.
So building on the convergence of the two worlds idea, crowdfunding world is kind of known as the cowboys right now, and the people who raise money in the independent broker dealer channel charging high fees are the dinosaurs. And I think in the future we're going to kind of have cowboy dinosaurs who you know, the fees are going to come down. The due diligence and screening and vetting of players is going to go up. The game in the in the online world is going to change from trying to get money from someone's checking account to try to get money from their brokerage account and report back so that it appears as if the money never left. The asset is showing right on the existing brokerage account statement, because, and there's probably an RIA or an independent broker dealer getting paid a smaller fee to help screen the deal and guide their clients through it.
Yeah, much like the taxi drivers are getting disintermediated by Uber, I think you're going to see tremendous, my opinion, is going to see tremendous disintermediation of current models once this works in a grand scale. You know, now Steve had a question back there.
A concern. I mean, that's why I won't name names, so please don't ask me to, but there are certain crowdfunding platforms for that very reason I shy away from.
Like which ones?
You have to get her after the cocktail.
She's on a record.
Yeah. Yeah. So I get very concerned about that. I also get concerned about, you know, people who call me and say, I'm going to start a crowdfunding platform and I don't want to follow any of the rules, so tell me how to do that. Or, you know, like, they're not that direct, but they basically say, I want to do everything possible to avoid doing this the right way. That's basically what they say. And to that, I say, please lose my number, because I don't want to have anything to do with that.
Joel?
You know, I think that beside them having bad business models, and the platform business is a terrible business model for most companies. There are tremendous conflicts of interest that are built into this business that are just not well known. For example, a lot of these companies use this concept called reverse syndication, where if they're venture funded, they'll take down the property first, mm-hmm. and then they'll syndicate it later. Not if you remember, you know, like the stock market used to operate this way, and every movie made from the 60s to the 90s made a big joke about this. The big boss would get on the horn and he'd say, all you brokers, we just took a position in some crappy stock, sell it to all your best customers. Well, that's effectively what these platforms are doing. When they use their own money to buy something and then they got to get reimbursed, they got to crowdfund the reimbursement to their line of credit, they're not brokering now they're trading. And that's a totally different thing. Tremendous conflict. I mean, it really puts them at a...
Is it a conflict?
Why?
Is it a conflict, or is that actually the business model? If you're looking at On Deck now, from an SMA lending, 86% of the loans that they're issuing are on their balance sheet because they can't sell the product through. They're effectively becoming a bank.
Well,
same thing with Prosper and lending.
Are they doing that... Are they doing it on purpose, or is that an unintended consequence?
Yeah, the intermediation model is somewhat suspect.
What is that statistic? Where did you see that
stat? Oh, public filing.
You know, I mean, listen, if they have enough money to keep going, that's fantastic.
Well, but if they raise a lot in the capital market.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, but if the capital markets didn't give it to them for that reason, they're not going to continue to give them the money. I mean,
one of the reasons the public companies have been depressed.
Well, yeah, I mean, if they used operating capital or they used some other form that was supposed to be recycled and now they're using it short-term money on a long-term basis, somebody's not going to be happy. And there's going to be cancellation of their lines of credit and other things are going to happen. So, but the conflict is that we all think that they're crowdfunding, but in fact, they're not crowdfunding. They're actually selling their own securities, which is now something from, I don't know, to me, that's a really big problem. I get why they do it, but to me, there are conflicts with them taking fees, there are conflicts with broker-dealer issues, there's conflicts with ownership, and these are issues that people just don't understand.
Well, how is that different than the Wall Street investment banking model?
Well, you know, some of them... Let's put it like this. If they underwrite, then they're guaranteeing a certain amount of capital to a deal. It's pre-sold, so that it doesn't happen very often. Yeah. And if it does happen, they're scrambling like crazy.
Well,
so,
percentage? I have a question for you. Yeah. What percentage of the future is going to be debt versus equity? Is it going to be more debt? We're going to see an increase in equity. I know a lot of people. Yeah. And the past too,
like
Steve.
Gallery over here.
Steve, I have a question. I'm asking why does the IRA trust are interested in real estate crowdfunding?
It's their number one asset class. It's a $100 billion industry, of which 60-70%, so 60-70 billion dollars is invested in real estate.
And how's it being done now versus the future?
It's
split probably between mom and pop fix and flips and notes.
Mm. And what's it going to be? We're going to see it go towards platforms?
That was the direction of the National Association.
Yeah.
They wanted to bring this online.
Okay. Right.
So the other companies tried it and they were not very successful. They only had the landing page. What's the difference
than
you guys
got? The entire process is now automated. So, especially if there's a time sensitivity, either through an issuance or a specific deal, they would usually lose out on the deal. They would have a 2 to 4 week horizon, and, they're into week 6 and 8, so... You capture more money because it's efficient.
So can my girlfriend just take money out of her IRA and just put it on a patch of land or something?
Through a self-directed IRA, yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yep.
When you say it's going to be faster, you're just the software. How do you know that IRA services or Untrust or iPlan Group will react so fast? They have their own routine and bureaucracy,
etc. Right. So in this case, with this particular ISCP platform, right now it's limited to IRA services. Phase two of this is to white label it to multi-custodian, especially what we call the third-party administrators, where they're the wholesalers.
One more question.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
No,
One last question, Sydney says. Anybody... any rednecks out there? Dara.
Well, I was just going to address, Joel, what you had said before about the trolls in the industry that are, looking to start suing for as they invest on a platform and then a week later say that, they're going to sue for invest $5,000 and a week later sue for $30,000. That's, I think, where the tough, noogie solution actually comes into play. That's the answer. I mean, it's tough. You invested, there shouldn't be that opportunity.
Yeah.
Fraud, yes, but,
Right. Here's the thing, and you can weigh in too, because it's an attorney, but, as a fund manager, somebody calls you up and they say there's some problem, and then an attorney sends a letter, and, and businesses make decisions based on cost benefit. And you say, look, it's going to, I got to call my attorney, and he's going to handle it because two attorneys have to talk to one another, and the whole thing. So, and the attorney calls and says, look, it's cost me $20,000 to resolve this. Why don't you just give him $20,000 and get it over with? So tough noogies is a great idea, but in reality, when attorneys are involved, that doesn't happen. So, you know, and I'm not saying this, I'm very bullish on crowdfunding, but there are some things that we need to overcome, and that's one of them. So we're taking some specific steps to do that. You know, I'd like to... If they're non-accredited investors, they sometimes don't always act like grown-ups, and that's where the repercussions get ugly.
But okay. the biggest troll is not an unaccredited investor.
Who is it?
State regulators. State regulators are going to be the biggest troll because the Jobs Act, the SEC, Congress, the president have all stripped them of so much control, and they're not happy about it.
Well, they're not stripped of fraud, though.
No, but that's why this is their new. So several years ago, I talked to the commissioner of Colorado. One of the projects I took on when I first started becoming a securities attorney to build my practice, I decided to call every single state securities regulator and talk to somebody at the state level to see exactly how their state reacted to certain things. And the commissioner of Colorado answered the phone when I called the state of Colorado. And he had the greatest thing to tell me, because I was asking him about specifically intrastate offerings in the state of Colorado, and he says, Jillian, you know what my favorite thing to do is? And I go, what is that? I said, what is that, Mr. Commissioner? And he goes, my favorite thing to do is, now this is back in 2007, he goes, my favorite thing to do is to get a newspaper, open up to the classifieds, get myself a cup of coffee, and start reading, looking for investors. And then I pick up the phone, and I call them, and I say, I'm interested in investing. And then they say, great, I'll send you all of our information, and you can send us money. And then I hit them with a cease and desist letter, and that's a good day for me. And this is the commissioner of Colorado telling me this.
Yeah, no, but can I elaborate on that? I mean, I live in Silicon Valley for about 15, almost 16 years. They can't stop that. This is part of a fintech. You know, we just had a report in
right.
60 Minutes, all these young kids that I do, accelerators, now, you know, entrepreneurs, they couldn't stop, you know, that big union for taxi drivers, you know, Uber we have Airbnb, you know,
yeah.
The biggest hospitality industry in the world does not own one hotel room, mm-hmm. or transportation for that matter. Right. And I see crowdfunding will be just a vehicle for the crowd collaboration. Mm-hmm. There's not stopping.
I don't think they're going to stop it. They just have to change the way they go after people.
Yeah.
And this is going to be their new level of, now we're going to go after people on crowdfunding portals, or we're going to go after portals. So they have to do something. They got to justify their paycheck.
Yeah, no, but we as a media, we keep it top of people come with a wild, which is good. They come with a wild idea to come do some crowdfunding. And one of the biggest successful is GoFundMe. Nobody knows that. They raise a lot of money, you know, and, you know, maybe they had some grandmom, you know, fake other thing over there, but I'm serious. A cat dying somewhere. That company sold for over $800 million. It's not a joke.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a lot of fun was going on that. But this is the SEC issue. This is all about finance. And as long as we have good lawyers and, you know, people around that they're successful, they transform themselves to this crowdfunding, I think we're going to have a successful.
Question?
I wanted to just say on the fear of lawyers, I'm a lawyer, and so we're not unreasonable. So even if that unaccredited person comes in and says, I lost my $5,000 and I want to do all this, the way these are set up, there's not a big incentive for a lawyer to go in there and take that case.
Right.
That's what's going to
happen.
Right.
That's what I've heard.
Right.
He's not going to do it.
That's what I'm saying.
So don't worry about that so much. You'll have some calls, but lawyers won't be beating down your doors to go after some little crowdfund offer.
Yeah,
I cannot do that.
This also takes you right back to what Joel was saying about being able to handle the investor relations. So we run properties that have been syndicated by all sorts of people, some of whom are better than others at their screening process. And what we found is that 99.9% of the client, even when they're upset, if you respond to them promptly,
yes.
Tell them the truth,
yes.
They will work with you.
Yes. The communication with the shareholders is critical.
You've got good investor relations, and you're not trying to take the law.
We've got one last question.
Yeah.
Puya? Puya?
Right.
They're going to one deal, and this huge amount of money, they create themselves kind of a bull market. And the probability of this market falling down is also huge. And those investors will lose all their
I would never encourage my aunt, and I would never encourage her to take all of her money out and put it into one real estate deal. That would be really bad advice for a lot of different reasons. I wouldn't even encourage her money to take it out and diversify it against real estate in general. She doesn't have any real estate experience. All I was saying is that if she wanted to hedge against the stock market, was to and actually, I did recommend a fund. I didn't recommend a specific property. I recommended the Fundrise E-REIT, one of the E-REITs. There's two Fundrise E-REITs that are both, one's a growth and one's an income REIT. And so that's what I recommended to her in particular.
Well, my daddy always said, always leave a party while you're still having a good time. So why don't we close for
was
now?
Was he a redneck?
Thank you all for coming.
I don't think you're the best.
And I told both my husband and my partner, I said that RefaCom was worth it because I talked to one guy at lunch.
Let me announce that there are some cocktail. Hello, there are some cocktail hour. It's in the other side of the room over there. That we have a room designated right there for the cocktail hours, and while you have it, so we have some cocktail and hors d'oeuvres. Thank you very much. That concludes our first day. Thanks for our sponsors. Thanks for our speakers. Yeah, and thanks for our sponsors, and thanks for all of our speakers, audience. Thanks for being part of this our third annual. Tomorrow morning, we'll have an open discussion. You're more than welcome to voice your opinion. Thank you very much. Good day.